Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Season 2 of Pack the Rod Podcast. I'm your host, Audrey Marr, and I am joined by my fellow HN football reporters, Kylee Corman and Carlo Barone. In Episode 4 of this season, we'll be covering the Indiana State game, giving some of our predictions on this week's Louisville game, and we'll be adding a new section to the podcast, which we'll be getting into in a bit. But first, Carlo, Kylee, how are you doing? How are your weekends?
It was a rough weekend for anyone that likes football, I think. Unless you're a Packers fan.
Yeah, it was a bad day.
I was going to say, I had quite a weekend. You know, Jordan Love played well. And other than Aaron Rodgers getting hurt, it was pretty flawless football weekend on my end. The game was cool that we covered. We did a good job. And then college football had some good games. And the NFL week one was awesome, except for Monday night. In the first half, the second half was amazing. The punt return, I don't know if you guys watched it, but that was unbelievable.
Crazy.
And if you guys watched the Hard Knocks clip too about that guy, it makes it all that much better. So I had a great weekend, Audrey.
Now reports are coming out that Taylor Swift and Travis Kelce are together.
Oh boy, here
guys,
we go.
Kylee is actually heartbroken of this news. Heartbroken.
But there was another Twitter post that said, like, he's a good guy. He's attractive. He makes his own money. He's got a job. There's no way she'd be. So maybe we're still in the clear, guys.
It was really hard for Kylee to come in today just when she heard that news.
Yeah,
but
I'm heartbroken.
Devastated.
Crying on the floor. Gonna have to listen to Taylor Swift to get over it.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's the way to do it.
It might be. Okay, well, starting off, it does seem that Indiana finally found an offensive rhythm on Friday, and they were able to score 41 points offensively in the game. I mean, with the 41-7 win over Indiana State, how did you guys feel overall about their performance and the win?
Overall, if I'm Indiana, I'm happy with that game. I think it answered a lot of questions about quarterback. It showed that the offense actually can produce. The defense, I will say, didn't look as impressive as it did against Ohio State, but I think that's kind of like a given. Indiana State's not Ohio State. So overall, I'd be happy with that game.
Yeah, they came out and they played a good offensive game, definitely in the second half. First half was very okay. They came out of the gate hot, and then they got cold early. And Allen talked about after the game how the second quarter he didn't really like their effort. And felt that they got ahead, and then they kind of just laid off. Second half, though, they came out, and they punched them in the mouth. Other than the Jalen Lucas fumble that got returned for a touchdown, I mean, this game is 41-0. So without one play, it's a 40-point shutout. Shout out all the Giants fans that listen to this. Your team got 40'd as well. But regardless, they need a performance like that and eventually solve their quarterback problem, as we're going to talk later, but Allen named the starter on Monday.
Yeah, I feel like they needed that game for confidence, especially going into Louisville. And not just confidence, on the field, but also with the coordinators. I mean, Walt Bell was a lot more aggressive in his play calling, I felt like. And that's what Indiana needed, for sure.
Yeah, I agree. And, I mean, we talked about it a little bit. We were finally able to see some of that offense at work, which we didn't really see at Ohio State. But with that, we saw a lot more potential on the team apart from that defense, which we did see at Ohio State. Can you guys give me an MVP from what you saw just on both sides of the ball?
Honestly, offensive MVP is probably going to be Omar Cooper. I feel like he was the wide receiver that made his name most relevant in the second half. He was the only guy to break 100 yards, which is crazy to think because him and Donovan McCauley were high school teammates. They talked about it a million times on Monday, but the fact that they're in the same wide receiver room is cool and it's funny, but I think Omar Cooper definitely broke out this game, and he's going to be someone that Louisville is going to have to game plan for. Him and Cam Camper are a very low-key scary wide receiver one, wide receiver two combo that IU has. They've got good skill players. They've got three good running backs. They've got some decent wide receivers. I mean, they've got the guys. It's really just dependent on the quarterback and the offensive line.
Yeah, I said that my MVP is Taven. I think that he showed up. He showed leadership. I didn't know that he had that in him just based off the Ohio State game. I don't know if he was playing not timid, but a little timid. But I felt like he really was taking some chances there. He did what was asked of him. 18 for 21, 236 yards, and a rushing touchdown. A pretty decent performance from him, really. But I think you're absolutely right. All the offense looks good. It's just the offensive line and the quarterback need to really get it together. I think the offensive line has looked way better than last year. What more could you ask for? And as for quarterback, as long as he can maintain that confidence, stay healthy, and just keep pushing, making plays, I think this is going to be a pretty decent Indiana team.
Mm-hmm. And how about defensive? You guys have anyone to point out?
I mean, I'm looking at the stats. Phillip Dunham, I didn't realize he had seven solo tackles, one assisted tackle. I mean, that's two games in a row. He's played outstanding. I think he kept his receivers in check, and he did a good job in the run game, stopping them short. So, I mean, just looking at this, the tackle numbers immediately jumps off the board when you have a guy in the secondary leading the team in tackles for the game. I mean, you're clearly doing something right. And we didn't hear his name a lot when they were throwing the ball, which is always a good thing for defensive backs. So, I mean, if you're stopping the run and you're keeping your guy in check, what else could you want from a defensive back?
Yeah, I was going to say Phillip Dunham, too. He's so young. He's got so much potential, so much promise, and really someone that this defense needs, especially looking forward. So, yeah, I was impressed with him, and obviously Aaron Casey, I think he was next under him for tackles. But the defense looked pretty good. Like I said, not as great as before, per se, but still a good Indiana team.
Yeah, and, I mean, obviously we're really highlighting this offense. And in the beginning of the game, we saw E.J. Williams go down with what looked like a hand injury in the beginning of the game. And then later in the game, we saw Cam Camper go down as well. Was that a leg injury?
We don't know.
We don't know, yeah. But status is unknown, so we won't fully go into that. But with the top two receivers out of the game, redshirt freshman Omar Cooper Jr. really stepped up for the team and ended with seven receptions for 101 yards. Yeah. How impressed were you guys? Do we think that he'll be utilized more throughout the game, even with a healthy E.J. Williams and Cam Camper, now that we saw that out of him?
I think so. I think right now, besides Cam Camper, I would say he's probably the lead receiver, just purely based off performance. He was the one that led the team in reception yards. I think Cam Camper is the reason he's the number one is because he's been the veteran on the team, and he's played a year and shown that he is capable of leading the offense on the receiving end, obviously before he got hurt last year. But I think the battle for Omar Cooper and E.J. Williams for that number two, number three role is going to be good for each other, because they're going to have to battle each other for the spot, which means it's going to make both of them better. So I think having a problem with who your number two and number three receiver is great for Indiana, especially a team that needs as many open receivers as they possibly can get. So I think Omar Cooper eventually will probably take more snaps as wide receiver two versus E.J. Williams. But then again, it's a very young season. We're not even in Big Ten play. One of these guys might go down anyway. Cam Camper went down. So I'm sure one of them is going to have to step up and play more significant snaps, regardless whoever ends up being the two or the three.
I was definitely impressed with Omar Cooper Jr. I can't exactly say that I was surprised, because he was my pick for the round table, and I think I mentioned it in the podcast too. But if you look at his stats, I mean, obviously it was only week two, but look at his stats around the other top wide receivers of college football, and I mean, those are the kind of stats that you're looking at. About seven catches for a little over 100 yards. I mean, I'm pretty impressed with him.
Yeah, I agree. And, I mean, we talked on to the wide receivers, but now let's kind of get into the news of the week. I mean, Taven Jackson, after going 18 for 21 and 236 yards against Indiana State, and breaking news, if you haven't already heard, Taven Jackson has officially been named the long-term starter for the Hoosiers. And let's just start going over the game. What did you guys like or not like from what you saw from him on Friday?
I felt like he looked very confident. I felt like he looked a lot more confident than he did in the Ohio State game. And I felt like he could really lead the offense. He convinced me, and that's what we said last week on the podcast, these guys need to take a little bit of both from each other and take control of that team. And we saw Sorsby too, and I think he did a good job. He had a good drive there, but it just ended in a field goal, I believe. But there was just a lot better execution, I felt, under Taven. And I'm excited to see what else that he's going to do this season.
I think Taven, he looked like the starting quarterback when he was on the field. He looked like he had all the tangibles that you need in your starter, your leader, your passer, your game manager. He had it all. 18 of 21 tells me he was super efficient. And then also tells me he wasn't forcing anything, trying to win the job with a flash play or anything. He said it in the pot, or in the press conference, that he wanted just to win the game. And that was the thing he took away the most, not trying to win the job. And honestly, I know he's trying to win the job, but I believe him, because you wouldn't only have three incompletions if you weren't playing team first and you weren't trying to make the splash plays that eventually would win you the job, the 50-yard bombs down the field or any of that. He looked like a good game manager. And that 18 of 21 tells me he was super efficient in leading the offense as well, because he's not forcing anything, but he's also giving it to his running backs. Jalen Lucas had two 25-yard touchdowns on plays that he could have kept it and ran, but he's giving it to him. So I think audibling to the run game was something that people aren't really talking about. But Taven, he was a great game manager. And honestly, he did a little bit more than be a game manager because of his passing numbers. I think in the second half, he let it rip a little bit more. But overall, he looked great. And honestly, I'm not surprised that he won the job.
Yeah, and now on to the season, Taven talk. Do we think that this is the right decision for long term? I mean, I know Coach Allen said that he does play better than he practices. He said that at the press conference. But is a game against Indiana State a good indicator for a big decision like this?
I think yes and no. They were looking at two completely different opponents, and I thought Taven looked completely different both games. Sorsby maybe looked a little bit more consistent, so that might be something to look forward. But now that Taven has played in two very different games and he had the opportunity to gain that confidence, if he can maintain that confidence throughout the season, then I say when Dexter comes back, we're going to be revisiting this quarterback battle again, because he looked very good. But I don't think that you can discount that it was Indiana State, not the best football team that they're going to see all year. So I'm really excited for this weekend to see what if that team that played last Friday can carry over to Sunday in Indy.
I think we'll know if this is the right decision as soon as Saturday, because if he comes out and he looked really good against Indiana State and he looked really bad against Ohio State. And I'm expecting this weekend to be somewhere kind of in the middle. I assume he'll probably throw a pick or turn the ball over once, but he might have enough plays where IU can win the game. I'm still undecided who I'm going to pick for the game, which we'll get to in later, but I think we'll know a lot this weekend. The game, now he's playing it, not an overly great team and not a team that's barely Division One. You've got one kind of in the middle. I would even lean more towards a good program. That if he throws for over 200 yards and a touchdown, especially if he doesn't turn the ball over, it will be the right decision. But if he just melts down and he can't really throw the ball, and we've got a graphic on the screen that says IU has four completions the whole game, it's the third quarter, I don't think it'll be that bad, but we'll see. This weekend is going to say a lot.
I think last week on the podcast, we really stressed that Indiana really needed to take advantage of that Indiana State game and really work out their kinks and take advantage of being able to produce a powerful offense. And I think this week, the stress of this podcast needs to carry over to Saturday. And again, like I said before, not just on the field, but from the coaches as well, I think a huge factor in this game, which obviously this is not groundbreaking news or anything, Bell needs to continue to be more aggressive with his play calling, and he knew that he was more conservative against Ohio State, and you brought up turnovers. That's always a possibility, but you cannot play in fear of creating a turnover.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And more Taven talk. I mean, it's known that Indiana plays in the hardest conference division in the nation. So how do we think that he will be able to handle more of the conference play once that part of the season hits?
Well, if he holds his job from Dexter Williams, he should have Louisville and Akron to really get right. And he starts against at Maryland, which is not the worst game in the world. It is on the road, which the difference between IU on the road and IU at home, I mean, at least last season, was it was astronomical. Completely different teams. So if they don't look like and come out looking like slow on the road, I think he could do well. He's getting an easy leeway into it. But I mean, I believe the next week after that, I do need to check it, but I believe they're at Michigan after that, which goes back to playing an opponent that's unbelievably good. But I think he'll have three games before he plays a team the caliber of Ohio State. And honestly, Michigan's probably better than Ohio State, but he'll have three games to get ready.
You're right about the Michigan, Maryland.
Yeah. I mean, at Michigan is going to be a hard game, whether Tom Brady was on or center for IU. Well, at least not right now, but you get the point. It's going to be hard, but I think he's got three games till he plays that really tough opponent to get ready. And if he's not ready by then, I mean, that's almost midseason. So that might be the time for a quarterback change if he's still on the fence about holding the job.
Yeah, I agree. But I do think for the most part, again, if he can maintain the confidence, which seems like he can, continue to take a hold of the offense, I would then say that Indiana's going to win a few more games than I might have said at the beginning of the year before anything.
How many are you thinking?
I don't know. So, I think in the round table I said four.
You said they'd win four. Yeah, I think we all said 4-8. So
maybe I'll give them five. I don't know. I don't know what five.
Spur of the moment question. Sorry, Audrey, to take the hosting away from you guys. Now that you guys have seen 2 weeks at IU, how many wins you guys have them still at?
Let me
still
have them at four?
Hey, I said, I don't know where I said it. I said somewhere in my round table. I do think that there is a slight chance of a bowl game. And now I think that's very possible. Okay. I think, like, yes, even with Taven, I think that they definitely have found a new offense. But I think that now there's games that are possible that I didn't think were possible before.
I think we can get into this weekend later. I think this weekend there's absolutely a shot. So let's say Indiana State, they won. Louisville, I think there's a shot. That's a maybe. Can I give it a 0.5?
Yeah. No. It ripped the Band-Aid off.
Akron, I'll say that's a
I would hope so.
A win. Maryland, that is going to be a tough game. At Maryland, this is not a horrible Maryland team. Michigan, no. Rutgers, homecoming, I have such a good feeling about this game. If everyone's healthy, that's a win. Penn State, that's tough. Wisconsin?
They're ranked.
Yeah, I don't know.
Mm.
Illinois is not the end of the world, I don't think. Michigan State is kind of
they're going to be a mess
right now.
Yeah.
So I feel like that's winnable. I don't know. I don't know if I lost count. So I don't know if you guys got that. But I don't know about a bowl game. I'll give them five games, though.
Okay, let's go through this.
Five and a half.
I definitely said Ohio State was not going to be a win. Indiana State, yes, won. Louisville, I don't think I was going to give that to them. But I think I am going to give that to them, and we can get into that later. But we'll go 2. Akron, 3. Maryland, 4.
Mm. That's not that hard of a take. Keep going.
4. Michigan, no. Rutgers, definitely. 5. Wisconsin. I definitely said no before, but they lost to Washington State. I don't know.
Do it. Come on.
Okay. I was going to go with like 0.5 like Kylee was. Okay. But Michigan State, I was going to say yes. The rest, I don't know. So I'm going to say 6 wins there. I say Michigan State, yes.
So. Purdue really hasn't impressed me so far, to be honest.
Here's my breakdown of it. The last three games, they've got 2 away, you got 1 home. They got Michigan State at home, they're at Purdue, and they're at Illinois. I think all 3 of those are very good chance of wins. Illinois and Purdue have not looked good so far. Yeah, Michigan State is just a mess as a program right now. I think that, I mean, they've already got one. They've got those three. If they should win, we'll see. I'm going to be honest. I think you guys are underestimating Rutgers. The last 2 years, they've played them, and I thought IU had a chance at both of them, and they got stomped.
Oh, absolutely.
Both times.
Absolutely. I can see them coming out flat.
I think one of them, they'll come out flat. Even one of those last three games, I don't see them going 3-0 in that because they're just such an unpredictable team and inconsistent. I could see them going 2-1 in those, and then you got Akron. The point I'm trying to make is that they're going to get close to six wins unless something astronomical happens. Now, if they lose all their quarterbacks and their injuries happen like they did the last 2 years, probably not. So,
I don't know. I do think that there is a lot more potential with this team, and I think we've seen a lot. I think we all said this in our roundtable that it's very early in the season that we don't know what these other teams look like either, and I think we've seen a lot now, too. I do think a bowl game is definitely possible with this Indiana team if this defense stays as powerful as it is and if this offense plays like they did at Indiana State. They can go really far in the season. Next up, we're going to move on to week three. And once again, we're going to just give some quick little predictions on the Louisville game. But make sure to tune in later this week as Dylan Traeger will be joined by Liv Clements, Noel Ferry, and Joe Brennan to go more in depth onto the game preview for Louisville. And first off, we've seen 2 weeks of Indiana and Louisville play college football. And from what you guys have seen, what do you think Indiana needs to do to capitalize in order to stay in the game? Yeah, just in order to stay in the game.
I think their biggest key is going to be winning the turnover battle because this is their first real opponent. Well, besides Ohio State, discredit them.
That wasn't a real opponent, though.
Real opponent essentially with their starting offense, which they can now fully game plan around Taven. So this is their first. I mean, it's pretty much their first team offense coming out. I mean, it's their first time really as a unit solidified because they just named Taven the starter. I think they're going to have to capitalize on the turnover battle, and I think that's more defensive-oriented more than offensive. If they win the turnover battle, I think they'll win the game, but Indiana's defense is going to have to play really well, and they're going to have to rush the passer, especially if they want to win this game. There's a couple things in football that you always have a chance. It's if your quarterback plays well and if your pass rush is hitting, and honestly, between the two, I think the pass rush is more likely to hit in this game for IU than Taven going off. So I would say they're going to have to rush the passer well, and their defense is going to have to make them win the turnover battle.
Yeah, their defense is going to need to be perfect. I think this is going to be a close game, but in order for them to win, they really do need to be pretty much perfect. Louisville is not a program to discredit by any means. It's a good-looking team. And their first game against Georgia Tech, they put up a fight. It was a little rocky at first. I was watching that game, and I was like, wow, Indiana might have a shot. But, I mean, they picked it up at the end and got it together, which that's another thing Indiana has struggled with is maintaining that momentum and playing all four quarters. So that, and this is a defense that is going to be able to put up with IU's star key players. Jalen Lucas, he's going to be locked down. I'm sure they know about Omar Cooper Jr. by now. He's not a secret coming off the bench. Again, we don't know the status of EJ Williams or Cam Camper. They are going to really, I mean, just utilize everything. It's going to have to be perfect.
Yeah, definitely. And, I mean, within these 2 weeks, we've seen two games with completely different offenses utilized for Indiana. Do we think we'll be seeing more of a passing-led or a rushing-led offense this weekend?
I think it's going to be heavily rushing just because it's Taven's first start as the guy. But the second half, especially if they're getting down, they're going to have to pass. So I think they're going to come out with their game plan as more run-oriented, trying to get some misdirections, you know, triple options, what they came out and did against Ohio State. But depending on how the game flow is, if they're not really controlling the game, they're going to have to throw it more. And that's when Taven was probably going to have to take some risks. And that's when I feel like IU could eventually lose the game is if you take one too many risks, pick six, fumble in your opponent or your own territory, something like that, whatever. I think they're going to have to come out with a more rushing-based attack, but if they can't control the game, they're going to have to throw it, and that's going to be the make or break of the game, if that is the case.
And to add to that, Louisville has historically not the best D-line, but last year they got it together and brought themselves up to be one of the best in the country. So that, I think Indiana, again, is going to come out with the rush game, but they're going to need to be able to adjust very quickly.
Yeah, and I mean, well, we'll leave the rest of the preview to the crew later this week. But for our final thoughts, let's just give our score predictions. What are we thinking? I'll start off. I'm 2-0 on my thoughts so far. But I think that this defense will kind of hold back Louisville a little bit more than they expect. This might be a hot take. I think that the offense is going to show up like they have, or like they did against Indiana State. I think Taven will have a good game. I'm going to go 34-28 Indiana.
There you go. See, this will be the first week we have some
Different stuff. Yeah.
And here's the first disagreement. I'm going to go Louisville wins 28-17. I think IU's offense comes out a little flat. Louisville gets off to double-digit head start, and IU's essentially fighting back. I think they do play better in the second half, but I think their first half woes will overwhelm them. Taven, in this game, in my predictions, he'll be okay, but he will definitely have to learn on the fly in the second half. I don't think he'll have the best game, but I don't think he'll have – I don't think he'll be the reason why they lose. Their defense giving up 28 points, I'm a little skeptical about in my prediction, but Jeff Brohm has played timeout plenty, so he knows how to game plan and against Tom Allen, and those scores have not been very nice in Allen's favor. So I think Jeff Brohm overall is the better coach, and he's right now has got the better program, so I will go 28-17 Louisville.
I am also taking Louisville. I'm saying 32-21. I think it's going to be neck and neck all the way up until the end. I think Indiana is just going to be in their usual rhythm of can't keep the energy. There was on Twitter a map of the seats, and it doesn't look like too many Indiana fans have bought up some tickets, which is a little tough. So I don't know. I don't know that they're going to be able to keep the ball rolling. I think it's going to be a good game. I think it's going to be a close game. But at the end of the day, I do think Louisville's going to be the stronger program, and I think they're going to score towards the end to just seal the deal.
All right. Well, that is it for our game talk. We are going to be moving into our new trivia segment of the podcast, where I will be asking Carlo and Kylee questions that they do not know. And in light of week one of NFL football, we are going to just go over some Hoosiers in the pros and welcome to our NFL edition of Pack the Rock Trivia. I guess we'll go with that.
I'm excited.
All right. So first off, we have...
How are we doing this? Are we like, or are we gonna like just blurt it out or what? Just blurt it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's blurt it.
All right.
Okay. First, we have who's drafted in 2018 fourth round, first pick in the fourth round. 2022, he had a little under 200 yards. He is on the offense of a team. Where is number 80?
Is it?
Oh, geez.
Nick Westbrook?
No, he's 15. No.
80? 80? On the offense.
He's got to be... He's a
yards?
He said he's 2018 and graduated from IU?
Yep, he was drafted in 2018.
Oh, jeez.
I can give you a conference.
Yeah.
NFC. South.
I told you the dates. I was not going to...
Jeez, I can't.
Is it a tight end?
Yes.
Is it Ian Thomas?
Yes. All right, Kylee wins the first point.
That's what I was thinking. But
I was thinking wide receiver the whole time.
That's why I didn't think Nick Westbrook was 80, but I didn't know who else that could be.
Okay. All right, next up, we have one that was just signed in 2023. He started his career at Indiana as a safety. And now he is in the NFL, number 44. I'm going like very, very vague to start off.
Is he AFC?
Yes.
Is it Jamar Johnson?
No.
I don't think he's in the NFL.
I thought he was in the
I think I know this.
44?
Yes.
Oh, oh, I can't cuss on you.
Give me more hints. At least one more.
AFC West.
44? He was signed this offseason?
Yep, 2023.
Jalen Williams.
Cam Jones.
Carlo got it.
He plays the Chiefs, yeah.
Yes, Cam Jones, linebacker.
He was signed.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
He made the 53.
He did.
Just respect. Did.
Yes, I was going to, I have that stat. That was what I was going to say next, but that would have given it away. Okay, so that goes to Carlo. We are 1-1. Next up, we have, this might be a tough one, I'm not going to lie. Next up, we have, he was signed in 2022. He wears number 72.
Caleb Jones, plays for the Packers.
Oh my gosh. That's why, the Packers. I actually just shouldn't have given that one, actually, because we knew.
Come on, Audrey.
He would have gotten
Packers
that.
Fan too.
That's true. I was just like, oh, this is going to be hard. I have Carlo Barone, Packer fan, sitting across from me. All right, next up, we have AFC South, drafted in 2020, or signed in 2020. I might have just given that away. Did play in week one, 58 yards. And he is not the main wide receiver in his position.
Is it Nick Westbrook?
Yes.
There you go.
I don't know, because we were literally just talking about him before that. I don't know how I could have given that without giving it away. I wasn't going to say number 15. Okay, next up we have another offensive position. He is, he had no catches, just one target in week one. He was signed in 2022, and he had 103 yards in 2022.
Peyton Hendershot.
Okay. There you go.
I really wanted to win.
We still have a couple left. We still have a couple left. All right.
I'm not great on my IU alumni.
All right. And next up, we have a starter. He was drafted in 2022 in the fifth round. He was the first team.
Micah McFadden.
Nice!
I was going
to
say that.
I know. Saying first pick 10 was a... was one to start with. All right. And wait. Okay, wait. That's it. That's all I have. Okay, finals.
What? All the ones that I know and were thinking of, you did not say.
What are you thinking of?
Raheem Lane.
Well, I was looking at
Dan Feeney.
I'm sorry. I was looking at, like, the most active. I tried to make it quick.
No,
easy.
No, I loved it. It was good.
Fun. Okay,
was
good,
I'm just
good.
Mad because I
We had, let's count it up. We had Carlo, Kylee,
yeah,
Kylee.
I had the first one.
4-2.
Did you count my first one?
Yeah, I did. Kay. You had Ian Thomas, Micah McFadden. Carlo had Nick Westbrook, Cam Jones, Peyton Hendershot, Caleb Jones. 4-2. 4-2. We have next week, but thank you for tuning into episode 4 of Pack Throb Podcast. Make sure to keep up with the Hoosier Network on Instagram, X, Spotify, and TikTok coming soon. And for all your Indiana athletic updates, I've been your host, Audrey Marr, alongside Kylee Corman and Carlo Barone. We'll be at the game this Saturday at Lucas Oil Stadium for everything you need to know, and we'll see you next week.